will you view so I can invite you? Because saying add viewers to be in your broadcast, no viewers to invite yet. So if you start viewing, I'll be able to invite you. Are you able to see me?
Nope.
Okay. Your viewers request to be in your broadcast.
Yeah, I can see you.
Okay.
And try inviting me.
No viewers to invite yet. I'll try again. Add viewers to be the broadcast. No viewers yet.
Yeah, I'm able to see you.
I'm not able to. It's not showing that you are here or viewing. Because once it shows
it
that you are.
It must be showing as LAJA is who you're viewing, right?
No, okay, wait. Now it's come. Go live with Vanna. Bring them on camera. Vanna is watching. Add. Oof. Is working now. It's adding you.
Okay, cool.
Yes. So we disconnect our phone.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Finally we did.
I know. Hello?
You're me now clearly, loud and clear?
Yes, I can hear you loud and clear. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Okay, audio is on. One second. Yes, yes, yes. Hello?
Hello?
Hello? I cannot hear you now.
Oh, good Lord. Okay, no issues.
One second, dear.
Yes. Yes.
One second.
Looking good? Dhanashree, can you hear me? Okay, I can't hear a word. Payal, I cannot hear you. I'm not sure if... Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
You loud and clear.
Yes. Okay. Now I can hear you, Payal. Okay, folks. Sorry for the delay in this really interesting and exciting interview that we are conducting. This is...
Hi.
I need to ask her about that. But we'll start off by asking her. I sent her a couple of questions earlier. But, you know, now that we've been talking, I want to know, what is your role as an educator, as a, you know, on such a sensitive topic? What is your role?
So, Vanna, what I am personally trying to do is trying to contribute towards building a sex-positive society. I think the first step was, I'm a writer and I wanted to put these stories of child sex abuse across to create awareness amongst parents and amongst society in general, because child sex abuse has had, at one point in time, was not taken seriously, right? As we all know, we started talking about POC about 5 or 6 years back. But I started work on my book because I was really affected by the impact that the CSA had, and there was no awareness. There was people were not talking about it. So as an educator, I didn't become an educator first. I became an author because my way of educating people was to write. So I penned down my book, and it was based on true stories of thrivers like Harish Iyer, Anurag Kashyap, and the likes. And that was my first step towards somebody who was just trying to help in creating awareness about sex and sexuality and sex education. After that, during the research that I made, what I realized is that as a society, we are sexually repressed, all right? Because we do not openly talk about these topics, you know, it's a taboo. And because of that, it does lead to a lot of sexual violence and sexual crimes. So especially children are just one of the, you know, section of victims, you know, but of course even women, as we all know. So what struck me was that one of the reasons was because we are sexually repressed, because we do not talk, it is leading to a lot of aggression, a lot of violence, a lot of crime as well. So what came to me is the book was a first step, but I wanted to do something beyond the book as well. Having a site which is dedicated only to sex and sexual health. So we came together as a team and we started this portal where we are actually trying to contribute towards creating a sex positive society, because we feel that if we normalize the conversations around sex, if we stop being guilty or feeling embarrassed or thinking that sex is a dirty word, I think it will really, really affect positively. I think the generation which is coming up, you know, the children, to educate them about sex in the right way, instead of, being very secretive about it or being very, embarrassed about it, we'll be able to communicate and make a better society and make a more successful society. So as an educator right now, this is my role. I'm trying to do my best, and let's see where it's headed.
No, but it's a great step, and I think we need more people like you around. You were talking about sensitizing the subject. How do you do that? Because, sex as a subject is, like you said, it's a taboo. People don't talk about it. And yet, it's like in your face. You switch on the TV and there is no song or no joke without a sexual connotation to it. So how do you sensitize your children to that topic? How do you shield them? Like, I have a 7 and a 4-year-old daughter, you know, both my daughters. How do I shield them? Should I shield them? And how do I sensitize them to the subject?
I think if you're talking about this age group between, say, 2 years to, say, 8 or 9 years old, because that is the time when they are, that is a very tender age when they're creating a lot of impressions and they do not have the maturity to understand certain things. So, yes, it is very important to shield them from the wrong kind of media and the wrong kind of exposure. It is very challenging as a parent in this day and age where, you know, gadgets are in everyone's hand. But it is up to us how to do it. So, yes, it is important to shield them. But at the same time, there are certain modules, or there are certain ways where as a parent, we need to be very open and not be too, averse to talking about sex and sexuality. But with children, there is a way of doing it. So what we need to do is, there are NGOs, like Arpan is one of the NGOs who is dedicatedly working towards sensitizing children about good touch and bad touch. Also, there are other NGOs who are doing their work. But I think that begins from home. You know, that education begins from home. So as a parent, I think first we need to, you know, see, children like stories. They like anthology. So it's, and you know your child the best. You know, every child has a different level of maturity. So I have daughters who are
True.
about 6 to 7 years old, and right from the beginning, I have been very open to them about the good touch, bad touch. And I always
Okay.
tell them that, you know, these are your private parts. No one has a right to touch you over there. No one has a right to kiss you on a lip. No one has a right to do X, Y, Z. Do not go with strangers. So I give basic personal safety tips I always keep giving them. So by
True.
now, they are matured enough to understand, and they know that, you know, there's a boundary that is set around them and that no one should cross that boundary. So that is the first
Okay.
step towards educating your children who are so young, you know, about sexual education. Secondly, I think we cannot talk very openly about sex because we are not mature enough to handle or understand that. But there will be questions that will come to you that, Mama, you know, they'll point out to your breast and they will ask you that, you know, what is this? Or they'll point out to your
Yes.
private part and they will ask you, what is this? So again, see, that is a very critical and a crucial moment when it depends on how you are going to react. That is going to determine how what they think about sex and sexuality in the future. So they look up to us,
Okay.
right? We are parents.
Yes.
So as a parent, we have to be sure that we do not put that thing in their mind that what you're asking is dirty. Do not embarrass them because they ask that question, because a child is going to ask a question. A child is curious. So it's not that
Yes.
it's a dirty question. The dirt is in our mind. So we need to be
True.
very normal with them. And just like we explain other things, for example, if they ask you about the solar system, you explain to them, right, that the planets revolve
Yeah.
around the sun. So this is also
Yes,
a very
yes.
natural question. So please take it naturally and tell them, you know, beta, these are your private parts, but these are private. No one else is supposed to talk about it in the public, or you're not supposed to say it out loud because it's private to us. It's your own thing. So explain to them in a very nice and a natural way. If you would like to use storytelling, please use storytelling. They ask you about your body part, say that this is mama's chest and it is called a breast. But let me talk about it openly. So it is a conversation that you had with your child. The child will not feel that this is abnormal or this is bad thing, this is bad. And he will go, or he or she will go back and satisfy them. So that's the first thing that you need to do as a parent.
Yeah, actually, coming to that point where you said, you know, when your child asks you, you tell her that, yes, this is my breast or my chest. I have come across many parents who have these nicknames for their private parts. And while it might sound very cute when they are kids, where it becomes, I think, even more embarrassing as they grow up. Do you really, do you advocate, and not just advocate, do you encourage such kind of behavior? Should you just call your breast, or should you call it something else? Should you call your vagina a vagina, or you know, give it a nickname?
No,
what do you suggest?
I think so. Okay, so let's do this. As a child, we should just say that these are your private parts, and if you do not want to call it a vagina, or you know, I call it the vulva, but I do not, you know, explicitly say it right now. Also, if it is, if they ask me, I just say it's a chest. I do not call it a breast, because I think that children of 4 to 7 years, I think they're a little too young probably to understand. If they say it out loud, sometimes it might get embarrassing for them and others will judge them. So, but please, let's not give these VVs and PP kind of names to the private part. Just call it
Exactly.
the private part. Just call it the private part, which is absolutely fine. And because in personal safety education also, if you have to explain good touch and bad touch, that's what we do. We just tell them that these are your private parts. The parts which are covered by the bathing suit are your private parts. So they know what a private
Okay.
part is. So you need not
Okay.
give it a name or, you know, or something, but please not even give it a nickname. Yeah.
Yeah, very important, I think.
Yeah.
Okay, coming back to that, you know, when we do this in schools, we have conversations with the children about good touch and bad touch. But I think we need to know where to draw the line, don't you think? Because in some cases, we have seen parents overreact to a touch or a child overreact, not the parents so much, maybe the child. You know, comes home and says that was a bad touch, and that when you sit and talk to them, it is not really a bad touch. It was just a pat maybe on the back, which was slightly lower, not done intentionally. So again, how do you help their children differentiate between that?
I think,
without getting obsessive about it.
Right. I think one of the definitions of a good touch and the bad touch is that any touch which makes you feel safe, happy, encouraged or motivated is a good touch. And any touch which makes you feel guilty, embarrassed, you don't like it, that's a bad touch. So more than where the person is touching or what is happening, it's about what the child is feeling. So you have to tell the child that, okay, you think it's a bad touch, but did you feel anything dirty about it? If that auntie touched you or kissed you, did you feel that embarrassed or did you feel that you didn't like it? So if the... It also depends on the intention of the opposite person. So, so you have to ask a child, how did you feel? Did you feel okay? Did you feel nothing? So if you didn't feel anything, if you didn't feel dirty or bad, it wasn't a bad touch. But that's how you differentiate between them. You have the child.
Okay. Oh, great. That's really helpful. Coming back to the questions that I sent you. India is the land of the Kama Sutra, and but why is it that we are still not so open to the subject? Why is it? Is it the mentality? Is it the upbringing? What do you think, as somebody who's seen lots of, you know, done lectures on this? What is your take on this? If I made any sense?
So, yeah, of course. And I'm really happy that you posed this question. One, because, so I have attended a conference on sex and sexuality by doctors. We also had a workshop sometime back, where we had invited gynecologists to talk about why is it that we do not talk about sex and sexuality so openly. Because these are doctors, these are sexologists, right? They would want people to come to them in counseling because, you know, there are, whatever said and done, there are issues amongst couples, amongst people about intimacy, but they do not go because they feel it's a taboo. You know, if someone comes to know that, oh, you know, I have got sexual issues, they feel very embarrassed about it. Well, it is okay, because to answer your question, definitely it is upbringing, it is our mentality, and it is the environment in which we have grown up, right? And this is, this stems from the fact that, thousands of years ago, as you said, the land of the Kama Sutra, when the Kama Sutra was invented or when it was written, of course, there was the environment was much more liberal at that point in time, you know. The women and men used to mingle more freely, and men could visit women, and, they had these places where women could. And it was absolutely fine. You know, there were no moral judgments around that. Now, what happened was, as we all know, that India was invaded by foreign forces, by the Mughals first and then the Britishers, all right? And because, you know, the Mughals and the Britishers, they were very conservative. They were very orthodox when it came to sex and sexuality. So, over a period of time, you know, even all that influences that we went through changed the way we, as a country, also started thinking about sex and sexuality. So in a way, there has been a huge change or transformation in the way we talk about or think about sex, which is in a way unfortunate. However, having said that, I think there is a new wave of change which is coming. At least people have started talking about the taboo topics, starting with menstruation. And people are more sensitive towards a topic like rape. And people are more sensitive towards feminism. So this is the time when that, I think, that whole, as you say, you know, when you bake a cake, you know, that whole thing is being created. And am I live? Are you able to hear me? Hello? Yeah, sorry. Yes. Sorry, I don't know if I got, if you, am I live?
No, that's okay. Yes, you are live.
I think I lost you in between, so I wasn't sure. So, yeah. So that whole cultural transformation that happened led to this change in the Indian mentality as well, which is, as I said, very unfortunate. But, well, times are changing, and I think it is up to us now, each one of us who really believes that we need a sex-positive society to start talking about sex and sexuality, do more workshops, or do more conversations like what we are doing right now. And as an individual, as a woman to begin with, we should shed these inhibitions, you know, that what if I start talking about sex, or what if I start talking about it in public? Well, we just need to have a conversation with each other first. Do not shy away from it. Do not be embarrassed about it. If you have issues, please go to a sex educator. Please go to a counselor. And it's very important for our sexual health as well. As I said, we have been repressed for so many years because, you know, there is no awareness. But now the time has come. The time is right and we should get these changes. I hope that answers your question, Vanna. Hello? Hello? Okay, so I'm not able to hear Vandana. Hello. I'm sorry, I'm not able to hear the questions. Yeah, I can see the questions. Yeah, so Vanna, if y'all can hear me, can you please type yes? I can see the questions. So if you can hear me, can you please type in a yes? Hello. All right, great. So I'm assuming that all of us, all of you can hear me. I see one question: to save time, how do we sensitize senior citizens towards sex? Okay, fantastic question again. Incidentally, we just did an article, a post on, does sex life stop at 40 or after 40? Incidentally, sex life can never stop because we all are sexual beings. Right from the time we attain puberty till the time we die, yes, the libido might reduce, or maybe the appetite for sex might reduce, but you cannot not have sex, so you cannot not have feelings about sex, and it is absolutely normal to have those feelings. I think in the recent times we have seen films like Lipstick Under My Burqa and even Badhai Ho, which talk about middle-aged sexuality, and it is time that we accept it senior citizens, you know, people who are over 45, 50, 60, 65 onwards also have a right to, they're sexual beings at the end of the day. Now, how are we going to sensitize them? It is difficult to, it is going to be through conversations. And like, for example, if you have a mother who is, you know, who's a senior citizen at home, I think it is okay to go up to her and, you know, start talking about it. Even if she throws a fit of rage, you know, how dare you ask me a question like that. But as a daughter, I think it is okay to go up to her and see if there are any issues she is facing. You will get your answer. I also feel that through whatever little means we can, you know, either by sharing content or by writing posts or by as one voice, as a community of women, it is up to us to bring these changes in society, because whatever said and done, men look at sex very differently, but I think as women, we have a very, we have a more emotional and a more spiritual experience of sex. I think we look at sex very differently than what men would. So it is up to us to bring that change. So I think that's how we are going to sensitize senior citizens to sex. Just the way, it begins at home for children. I think sex sensitivity for senior citizens also begins at home. So I'm ready for my next question. Would you like to send me another question? Okay, can you elaborate on that, Vanna? What about sexual health? So I've got your question. Would you like to elaborate a little on that? Okay, while Vanna is elaborating, I think I'll just talk about sexual health and hygiene. I think as women, we must understand that sex is extremely important for our well-being and for our health. And let's not put these issues under the carpet. If any of you have, sometimes what happens is very funny. We don't even realize that we are having a sexual problem. Sometimes we don't realize that, the reason for any kind of stress or anxiety that we have, or sometimes we even tend to get in depression, is because of lack of sex. So while physically sex, lack of sex is not going to affect you, but emotionally it definitely can. So if you have long periods of long dry periods, or if you have any sexual issues, I think it is absolutely okay to go and visit a sexologist. If you feel that it's more of a biological issue or a physical issue, then definitely a gynecologist. But please do not keep these things within yourself. Go and meet the right people, the counselors, and make sure that you stay fit and fine that way, because lack of sex can definitely affect your health in the long run, mental health especially, right? The next question I got is, what are the signs to look out for in terms of needs or wants? Great. So, as I said, that you know your body better and you know your needs and wants better. Some people have more sexual appetite, some women have less, which is absolutely fine. You need to listen to your own body. And if you have urges, and if you feel that, I have this urge, but it's not getting satisfied, then I think it is time we should stop thinking that, how can I tell my partner this? He will feel my kaisi aurat hu. It's not like that. Men go and find their own ways of satisfying themselves, So we as women also need to go and find ways of satisfying ourselves, okay? So probably no one ever told us that, masturbating is absolutely fine for women as well. So men can go and masturbate because, it's a natural instinct, but we as women would feel, especially like I have never done that in my life, when I was growing up, never, no one ever told me that even you can masturbate if you have these urges. But if you feel that you're not getting the satisfaction or you're not getting the orgasm, because it's very important to get that release, because it's important for your mental health, as I said. So if you feel that you're not getting a release and you're not, being satisfied with your partner, then you can satisfy yourself as well. There's nothing shameful or nothing to be embarrassed, because you're doing it in the privacy of your own room. Secondly, only you know it. So you have to share that inhibition within yourself. So please do not be, do not feel guilty or embarrassed that, what will people think or say. I mean, no one is going to know. It's your own private thing. It's your health. You have to take care of it. So it's nobody else's business what you do with your body. It's completely, for your own sake that you're doing it. So please do not feel that you're doing something wrong or sinful, no matter what people say on Twitter, no matter whoever your mom would have told you or some baba would have told you. Please do not think that there's anything wrong in pleasing yourself. If you have a partner, of course, it could be your husband or it could be a boyfriend or whoever it is. You can always open out to that person. You can always have a conversation, a dialogue with that person. Do not keep yourself, it is difficult because, we feel very shy and we feel that how am I going to tell, my husband that please do this to me, please do that. But I think it is okay to, start these little bridge these gaps of, start talking to him or tell him, what I really think, I like this, can we try this, in a very nice and a soothing way, and find ways and means of making sure that you are satisfied in bed. It's important that you are, otherwise, that irritability and that stress and that anxiety and that feeling of dissatisfaction will just kind of pile in, and over a period of time, it can get a little, it can affect you mentally. So yeah, that's my two bits on sexual health and hygiene. So I'm ready for my next question. Okay, so
I'm back.
Yes, great. Hi, nice seeing you. At least now I have a face to converse with.
Yeah,
I love this question. How important is it for young girls to meet with sexologists, gynecologists, etc.? I think it is important that we do not wait for the girl to be like too old to know what she's going to undergo. Because these are natural things, and I think we need to be first very, very accepting of the fact and very natural about it, instead of feeling that something big is about to happen. It just anyways going to happen. It's just all that big deal is in our mind. So whether we have a daughter or whoever it is, I think by the age of 11 or 12, just before she's about to probably get her first periods, it is better to orient them and at least start talking to them about the changes that she is going to expect. So that when it comes, she is ready and she doesn't feel that, this is something to be shy about or something to be embarrassed about, right? That is the first step. How do we know that what is the right time to take her to a sexologist or a gynecologist? I think first, as a mom, we need to talk to our daughters about sex and sexuality, about the urges that she will have. But I think that just before she's probably 18 or 19, where she might want to probably go out. I know we do not believe in premarital sex, and a lot of families do not. I do not advocate either. But it's always better to educate your children, whether it's a boy or a girl. Tell them that, it is possible that you might come across a situation like this when you want to probably have relationships with somebody. But it's great that you know these things, X, Y, Z. Talk to her about safe sex, talk to her about condoms, see that you put her mental on your own. For that, as a parent, you also need to educate her.
As a parent, that will be a big step on our side also.
Absolutely.
Massive.
Massive. And see, there are these sex educators also who do sessions for parents. You can also visit a sexologist as a parent and take counseling from them, you know, that my daughter or my son is so and so age. How do I talk to the person? How do I, you know, instead of taking them directly to a sex educator or a you know, counselor, because they are strangers, all right? So the child is not going to be comfortable with them. So it's up to you, like how as a friend, you are going to open the conversation with them and in a very nice and natural way. So I think, and just probably just by 2021, or maybe just before they're going to get married, maybe you can introduce them to a sex counselor or a sex educator. And maybe the counselor or the educator will probably give them tips, you know, to healthy sex behavior.
This is like a never-ending thing, and I know there are like so many questions popping up in my mind, but time is against us. And I would also like to let our viewers know that Payal is in the midst of a wedding celebration. She's actually, sitting all she's all dressed up and she's sitting in the car and doing this conversation with us. And I appreciate that so much. Thank you so much for keeping your part of the deal. And
I'm so sorry for the time that we lost. And
I know.
Sometime again later.
I know. Yes. I would like to have you back again sometime. And hopefully we have better connections at that time. And yeah. So with that, I think it's 8 o'clock. I don't want to keep you any further. And thank you so much, Dil Se, for doing this with us.
My pleasure, Manna. Thank you, guys. Thank you, the team, LAJA, for doing this. It was fantastic. And I really hope the viewers got a lot of value out of this.
I got, as a mother of two daughters, I got a lot of valuable information. So, and I'm sure that the others were also found this useful. So, thank you, dear. Thank you so much. And with that, we end this live talk with Payal Shah. Thank you, dear. And that's it. Enjoy the wedding.
Thank you. Thank you. See you soon.
Okay. See you soon. Bye. Bye.